Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor P. Bhaskar Reddy, Department of Ancient Indian History, Culture and Archaeology, Sri Venkateswara University, Tirupati, Principal Investigator of the Project Indian Culture and also Course Coordinator for the paper Outlines of Indian History. In this module, you are going to learn about the history of the Gupta Empire. The learning objectives of the study are significance of the Gupta Empire, sources for the study, origin and foundation of the dynasty, achievements of Chandragupta the first, Samudragupta's career and achievements, achievements of Chandragupta the second, importance of Vahyan's visit to India, Kumaragupta and his successors, decline of the Gupta Empire, and contribution of the Guptas to Indian culture. Let us start our discussion with the introduction of political situation in India before the establishment of Gupta Empire. The decline of the Mauryan Empire witnessed the rise of many indigenous and foreign powers. Kushanas dominated the North India, whereas the Shatavahanas dominated in Deccan. The eclipse of two empires, Kushanas and Shatavahanas, ushered political disintegration. This paved the way for the rise of many ruling families in various parts of India. Against this background, Guptas laid a foundation for the empire and they contributed for various aspects of Indian history and culture. The political as well as the cultural activities reached its highest peak. Let us know about the significance of the Gupta Empire in Indian history and culture. Gupta Age was the glorious epoch in the annals of ancient Indian history. This age is marked by the startling developments: emancipation of India from foreign rule, political unification of North India, transition from anarchic condition to well-ordered progress and prosperity, revival of Hinduism, birth of six systems of Indian philosophy, impressive works in Sanskrit literature, substantial changes in social, economic and scientific development. They also contributed for high quality and matchless progress in art, architecture and painting. By counting all these developments, historians acclaimed the period of Guptas as classical age or golden age. Let us start with discussion on Gupta history with the source materials. There are plenty of source materials available for the reconstruction of Gupta history and culture. They include inscriptions, coins, literature and foreign accounts. The Puranas, Vayu, Vishnu, Matsya, Bhagavata, Skanda and Markandeya, they provide solid information about the Gupta genealogy and their role. Vishakadatta's Devi Chandraguptam and Mudra Raksha, Kalidasa's Abhijnana Shakuntalam, Meghadutam, Sudraka's Vruchakatika, they also provide interesting information about the historical developments during the Gupta period. Along with the indigenous source materials, the foreign accounts, particularly Chinese travelogues like Fahian account, Huinsan account, Itzing account, they are also helpful to know about several political aspects of the age. Besides literary source materials, the inscriptions and coins of the Gupta period also provide authentic and reliable information to know about political as well as cultural history. Among the inscriptions, the important inscriptions are Allahabad pillar inscription of Samudragupta, Mehroli pillar inscription of Chandra, Junagadh rock inscription of Skandagupta, and Gupta coins also found plenty in various parts of India, both in gold and silver. They also useful to know about the history of the Guptas. Besides, the monuments which was raised during the time of Guptas also form as a source for both artistic and religious history. It also provide interesting information about different schools of art and architecture. See the excellence of the Guptas art, sculpture and paintings which was found in the Ajanta, Ellora and various parts of Indian subcontinent. So far, we discussed about the objectives, significance, source materials. Now, we can turn our discussion on the political history of the Gupta emperors. Regarding the origin and its beginning, it is shrouded in mystery and several controversies are there. It is believed that the Guptas belong to a family of wealthy landowners. Most probably, Guptas were of Vaishya origin. This assumption is based on the suffix Gupta. Genealogical accounts mention Surugupta as the first ruler, and he was succeeded by Ghatotkaja. Both had the title of Maharaja, vindicates that they are the initial founders of the Gupta Empire. Yit Singh, a later Chinese pilgrim, refers to Sri Gupta's permission to construct Buddha Stupa at Mrugasika, Vana, Benga. It means Gupta rule started as a small province in Bengal, probably as subordinates of the Kushanas. Later, they rose to prominence under the leadership of Samudragupta. From the evidence of Yit Singh, it is true that Gupta rule started as a small province in Bengal during the time of Sri Gupta, probably as subordinates of the Kushanas. Sri Gupta was succeeded by Ghatotkaja and later followed by the first great ruler, Chandragupta Maurya. See the genealogical list of the Gupta dynasty, starting from Sri Gupta up to N. The Guptas dominated over the destinies of India from that period up to the middle of 6th century. The first great ruler of Gupta dynasty is Chandragupta the first, who began his career in 320 BCE and continued up to 335 BCE with the duration of 15 years. He was the first independent king of the Gupta dynasty. He was described in inscriptions as Maharaja the Raja, means he assumed or he acquired emperor status. On the occasion of his accession, Chandragupta first founded Gupta era in the same year, 320 CE. The important achievement of his reign was the marriage with Kumaradevi, a Lichavi princess of the period. This matrimonial alliance with the Lichavis enhanced his power and prestige. Commemorated the marriage, he issued coins known as Chandragupta Kumaradevi coins. The political influence of this marriage resulted the amalgamation of the two states in later course of time. So the empire of Chandragupta during his reigning period, it includes the areas of modern Bihar, parts of Uttar Pradesh and Bengal. He was succeeded by the most powerful ruler of the Gupta dynasty, Samudragupta. Let us know about the career and achievements of this great ruler. Chandragupta was the greatest of all the Gupta rulers. His reign witnessed the expansion and the consolidation of the Gupta Empire. The prestige of Allahabad inscription issued by him and composed by Harisena. It described the achievements, conquests and personality. It also contained the list of states, kings and tribes conquered and subjugated by Samudragupta during his campaigns. The places and countries conquered by him were divided into four groups. One is Aryavarta, another is Eastern Himalayan states, the third is rulers of Eastern Deccan, and the fourth is foreign kings. Thus, he invaded all corners of Indian provinces and he was successful in his invasions. Besides the invasions, it is said to be that the Gupta power also extended over the territories of Sri Lanka. Meghavarna, the ruler of Sri Lanka at that time, sent presents to this ruler. This Sri Lankan king also said to have acknowledged the suzerainty of the Samudragupta. To commemorate their friendship, he was permitted to build a Buddhistic monastery at Gaya, where that Meghavarna constructed that monastery with the support of Samudragupta. As a result of extensive conquests, the Samudragupta's empire comprised much of northern India. The Shakas and the Kushanas were in the sphere of his influence. The kings of Deccan on south also paid homage. He covered a large part of the subcontinent through his successful military campaigns and political relationship. Military achievements remain remarkable in the annals of Indian history. He was an able and compensate ruler, concerned about the welfare of his subjects. To commemorate all these victories during his reign, he performed Ashwamedha sacrifice. On the occasion of Ashwamedha sacrifice, he issued gold coin styled by numismatists as Ashwamedha type of coins. Samudragupta was a great conqueror. Besides political events and achievements, he also contributed his might for the progress of Indian culture. He was a poet, musician, and patron of learning, and described as Kaviraja. As a poet king, he wrote Krishna Charita, a work in Sanskrit. His court was adorned by Sanskrit scholar Harisena. Already we mentioned that he was the composer of the Allahabad Prasasti inscription. By extending patronage to the Sanskrit scholars, he is credited with a share in the promotion of Sanskrit literature. He is also a great lover of music. His love of music is attested by his lyrist type of gold coins, where that coins bear the image of the king playing on Veena. He was a follower of Vaishnavism. Besides, he was tolerant towards the other creeds. He evinced keen interest in the Buddha and promoted Buddhism also. He was a patron of Buddhistic scholar Vasu Bandhu. Thus, Samudragupta's reign is a remarkable period in the history of Guptas, where he was the responsible person for making Gupta Empire as political power in northern India, and also contributed his might for the growth of cultural institutions during his reign. So far, we discussed about Samudragupta, his reign, achievements, and his contribution. Now, we can turn our attention to discuss another important ruler, Chandragupta the II, who ruled in between 375 to 414 CE. This Chandragupta the II was the son of Samudragupta and Datta Devi. The Gupta Empire, during his reigning period, reached peak of territorial expansion. However, the Chandragupta started his career with mysterious beginning. Several traditional stories are mentioned in the literary works. However, he had a long reign of 40 years. In this long reign of 40 years, Chandragupta the II also waged successive wars, and he was also responsible for the further extension of territories. The Gupta power reached its highest zenith during his reign. He waged a war against the Shaka Satrapa king Rudrasimha the III. The Shaka ruler was defeated and dethroned, killed and annexed the entire Shaka territories into the Gupta Empire. As a result, the Guptas gained control over the trade ports Broch, Sopara, Kambe and other ports. With this victory, Ujjain came under the control of the Guptas, and it became an important commercial city and as an alternative capital for the Guptas. To commemorate all these victories, Chandragupta the II performed horse sacrifice and assumed two titles, Shakari and Vikramaditya. Besides his victory over Shaka ruler, to consolidate his position, Chandragupta the II entered matrimonial alliances with a number of royal dynasties. He married Kubera Naga, the Naga princess of central India. He gave his daughter Prabhavati Gupta in marriage to Rudrasena the II of Vakataka dynasty of Maharashtra. Thus, he exercised indirect control over the Vakataka kingdom by this matrimonial alliances. Later, this Vakataka kingdom also became a part and parcel of the Gupta Empire. One of the inscriptions found at Mehrauli, it mentions several details about the King Chandra. Chandra of the Mehrauli iron pillar inscription had been identified with the King Chandra the II. From this inscription, we get a lot of information about his other achievements. He fought against the confederacy of enemies and occupied Bengal. He crossed the Sindhu, the region of seven rivers. He also defeated Valhikas, the Bactrian Greeks. With these conquests, the Gupta Empire during the time of Chandragupta the II extended in west up to Malwa, Gujarat and Kathiawar. In the north, it extended up to Hindu Kush and Bactria. In east, it extended up to Bengal, and south, Narmada is the boundary. The important event of his reigning period is the Chinese pilgrim Fahian visited India as a Buddhist missionary. Out of his 9 years stay in India, he spent 3 years at Pataliputra. By staying at Pataliputra, he visited several places and gave a graphic description about all the places he visited in the Gupta Empire and India. Thus, Chandragupta's reign witnessed a pinnacle of power and prosperity for the Gupta Empire. He also, like Samudragupta, extended patronage to literature and art. His court was adorned by Navaratnas, who are the great luminaries of Sanskrit literature. Kalidasa, the greatest Sanskrit poet and playwright, was one among these nine gems. See the territorial expansion of the Chandragupta the II during his time, and the map shows about the extension of the Gupta Empire in north as well as central India up to eastern India. Next important ruler of the Gupta dynasty is Kumaragupta. Chandragupta the II was succeeded by his son Kumaragupta. Kumaragupta issued large number of coins and inscriptions which they reveal the continuation of the Gupta glory during the time of Kumaragupta. He also performed Ashwamedha sacrifice. During the later period of Kumaragupta's reign, they record some political disturbances. The empire was threatened by the newly risen powers of Pushyamitras and Huns. But the danger was averted by his crown prince, Skandagupta. The reign of Kumaragupta up to his end remained peaceful. The most important contribution of him to Indian culture is he was the founder of Nalanda University. The Nalanda University emerged as an institution of national importance. Thus, Kumaragupta's name is still remembering because of the contribution and patronage extended for the progress of education in India. He was succeeded by Skandagupta. The Skandagupta was the last able and energetic ruler. The Junagadh inscription refers to the restoration of Sudarshana Lake, which had burst owing to heavy rains by this king. He repaired the breach and saved the country from a great calamity. During his time, the Huns already rose to prominence in northern India. They invaded the Gupta Empire. He fought them bravely, but the situation became complicated owing to several domestic problems. Thus, the Guptas lost some of the territories to Huns. The last known date of Skandagupta is 467 CE. The death of Skandagupta reduced the unity and stability of the Gupta Empire and started the disintegration of the empire. The history of the imperial Guptas after Skandagupta is shrouded in mystery. Various rulers were succeeded by namely Purugupta, Kumaragupta the second, Budhagupta, Narasimhagupta, Vinayagupta, Baladitya and others. All these rulers are known with dates but lacks clarity for the arrangement of genealogical and chronological order. Most probably the Huns already hastened the disintegration of the Gupta Empire. They became powerful at that time. But however, the Guptas continued to rule for another 50 years with nominal power. Vishnugupta was the last ruler of this family. So far, we discussed about the Gupta rulers, starting from Sirigupta, and the great rulers Chandragupta the first, Samudragupta, Chandragupta the second, Skandagupta, Kumaragupta. But after ruling 150 years, the Gupta Empire started to decline. Various causes are there for the disintegration and dismemberment of the Gupta Empire. The causes are Huns, the fierce nomadic tribe under the leadership of Toramana and Mihirgula, attacked and disrupted the empire. The successors of Skandagupta were weak and incompetent. It paved the way for the disintegration. The weakness of the central authority enabled their feudatories to assert independence. It gave a death blow to the political unity of India as well as Gupta Empire. The increasing dissensions among the royal princes, the decline of the trade with the Roman Empire attributed for the final disintegration and disappearance of the Gupta Empire. So far, we completed our discussion on the political history of the Gupta Empire, important kings, their reign, their achievements, their contribution to Indian culture in person. Now we can shift our discussion. Why the Gupta period is considered as a golden age or classical age? Because the contribution of the Guptas in all aspects of cultural history is immense and everlasting. Now we can shift our discussion, their contribution to Indian culture. The Gupta period is a glorious chapter in the history of ancient India. It witnessed a remarkable development in the field of literature. Education and learning attained matchless development. Sanskrit language became prominent. The Nagari script had evolved from the Brahmi script and it became important script for the production of Sanskrit literature. Already we mentioned that Chandragupta the II patronized Navaratnas. Kalidasa was the foremost among them. There was a tremendous progress in the field of mathematics, astronomy, astrology and medicine. Mathematical numerals, decimal systems were known to the people of the Gupta age because many scholars belongs to these fields were flourished and patronized by the Gupta kings. Aryabhatta, the great mathematician and first astronomer, flourished. Varahamihira, another great mathematician and astronomer and astrologer, he wrote several works. Bhrat Samhita, Yoga Shastra, Panchasiddhantika and others. Surya Siddhanta was another important work written by Brahmagupta. Besides this, in the field of medicine, the great medical trio also belongs to this period. They are Vagbhata, Charaka, Sushruta. With this, the medical education also received progress, particularly Ayurvedic and allied sciences. With the contribution of the Guptas, education reached its highest watermark with the establishment of Nalanda University by Kumaragupta. They were the followers of religious toleration and strove hard for the Brahminical revival, where they performed several Ashwamedha and Rajasuya sacrifices. Buddhism, Jainism and Hinduism flourished during the Gupta period. Gupta period is also an important, particularly in the history of art, architecture, sculpture and painting. With the development of several schools, the art and architecture reached a new techniques during their patronage. It heralded the classical phase in the history of art and architecture. The art of painting reached its highest of glory and splendor with the patronage extended by the rulers. Particularly, the Ajanta paintings became the best paintings in the world. That art belongs to Gupta age. The most important temples dedicated to Hinduism are found at Tigwa, Sanchi, Burma, Nachanakotura, Diyogar and Rock Cut Caves at Udaigiri. Thus, with all the contribution made by the Gupta rulers, the cultural institutions reached his highest watermark. Thus, the Gupta age is called as classical age in the history of ancient India. See the contribution of Guptas and their excellence in the field of art and architecture. Dear students, with the discussion on the history of the Gupta Empire. You may understand why the Gupta Age is called as Classical Age. Since their contribution in the political history as well as in the cultural history is rememberable. That's why Gupta Age, since we are remembered as the age of classical. For further details, you go through the e-text, self-assessment and further source materials for better understanding. Thank you.